brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I've just popped in today after challenging many different Shia scholars, specifically, you know, the famous Blade Runner, who comes down here, likes to speak about the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, specifically Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now, I just want to get one or two things clear here, that Shias, especially the Rafida, coming into speaker's corner here in this park, this is actually going against their own religion and their own books. Their 12 Imams have clearly said that coming out and opening the religion of Shiaism and opening, you know, the sect and their beliefs of the Rafiza, this is something because of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to disgrace them. This is their own books. So their whole, you know, the backbone of Shiaism, what has kept Shiaism, is to hide Shiaism. And I'll give you a few narrations just to prove that to you from their book that you've just been looking at, Sheikh, showing you, Usulul Kafi. In Usulul Kafi, one of their Imams, Abu Abdullah Ja'far al-Sadiq radiyallahu ta'ala, who also we look at as a muqaddas personality and a respectful personality, but we don't look at him and give him, you know, the status of an infallible divine Imam that is appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does he say? Well, allegedly this is what he has said in Usulul Kafi, innakum ala deenin man katamahu, that you are upon such a religion. He's telling his own Shias, he's telling them, innakum ala deenin man katamahu a'azzahu Allah wa man adha'ahu adhallahu Allah, that oh my Shia, you are upon such a religion that if you hide this religion, then Allah will give you honor and esteem in the dunya. And whoever exposes this religion, then adhallahu Allah, Allah will disgrace him. This is what Usulul Kafi. There are many such narrations which encourage the Shia to hide their religion and not to expose the religion. So all those Shia, Blade Runner, or whoever it is, when they come into this park, they are actually making themselves mustahik of the baddua of their own infallible Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq radiyallahu ta'ala an, because they are coming and they are opening their religion, and their religion should be hidden. Look, I'll give you another hadith from the Usulul Kafi. It says from, again, Abu Abdullah Ja'far al-Sadiq radiyallahu ta'ala an. He says, قال لي ما زال سرنا مكتوما حتى صار في يدي ولد كيسان فتحدثوا به في الطريق وقرى السواد. Look what he says that Ja'far al-Sadiq allegedly says that our issue and our religion was maktuman, it was all hidden, until it came into the hands of the children of Kaysan, and they fatahaddathu bihi fi tariq, they began talking about it and they began discussing it, and this is how we all messed up. So like I said, according to Shia scriptures, these Shias who are coming and talking about their religion and imama and refuting the Sahaba and opening their concept, this goes against the religion of Shiaism. Now here, this is the million dollar question, that can we call Shiaism Islam? Can we call Shiaism Islam? If the pillars and the stalwarts of Shiaism, if they are clearly saying that this is a religion which is supposed to be hidden, let's look at the Quran, because the Quran is the key to Islam. What does the Quran say? The Quran in Surah Saf, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرَسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. Allah has sent the prophets with guidance. Why? لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ, so that these prophets bring this guidance and they spray it over the dunya, and so that this religion, it overpowers and becomes dominant over every single other religion. Now this is what the Quran says about Islam, and you have the Shia Imams, they say that Shiaism should be hidden. This is a clear contradiction between Islam and Shiaism. Therefore you cannot call Shiaism Islam. There are many major differences, fundamental differences, usuli differences between the religion of Shiaism and between the religion of Islam. For example, I'll just give you a quick few differences. You have in Islam, you have Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the creator of the heavens and the earth. Yes or no? Yes. we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you have Shia scholars such as Khomeini, you have other Shia scholars who have clearly said, they have clearly said that whoever appointed Abu Bakr and Umar as a Khalif, we don't believe in that Lord. We don't believe in the God who appointed Abu Bakr and Umar as a Khalif. So there we have a major difference in Tawheed. If we look at prophethood, Allah says, ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين. That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is not the father of any man amongst you, but he is a messenger and he is the final messenger. There is no messenger to come after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But if we see the Shia and if we see the Rafi, if we look at the sect, they have a continuation of prophethood even though they don't call it prophethood. Let me give you an example. If I said to you, who created humans? You're going to say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes? Who gives us sustenance? We say Allah gives us sustenance. Who gives us rain? Allah gives us rain. Now if we begin attributing these qualities to any human, what are you going to say? You're going to say that this person is a mushrik, he is a kafir. Why? Because those attributes which are specific to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are attributing those to a human. Yes or no? Creation, sustenance, rain, the creation of the heavens and the earth. These are all attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are all actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now I just want to mention that if you look at prophethood and the Anbiya, the prophets, they also had traits characteristics or qualities which were specific to them. For example, revelation. Nobody except a prophet receives revelation. Number one, if you look, infallibility. There is nobody except a prophet who can be infallible. Number three, muftarizu ta'a. That it is obligatory to follow an individual. There is not an individual who comes after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam who you can say regarding him that it is obligatory to follow the individual, and if you don't follow the individual, you are sinful. Apart from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nobody's obedience is obligatory. But what do these people say? Shia say, no, our imams, they are infallible. So they are again an attribute of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is specific to him. They are attributing it to their imams. They are taking the attribute of the concept of muftarizu ta'a, obligatory obedience, and they are attaching it to their imams. Therefore, what do we say? That what do you people, how have you differentiated between prophets and your imams? There's no difference between them to such an extent. Baqir Majlisi in the 12th century, Baqir Majlisi, who was one of their top shot scholars, what does he say? He says that we do not see any difference between the prophets and our imams to such an extent that the only differentiation between them is the name. That's it. That they are called prophets, they are called imams, yet there is no other difference between them apart from names. So brothers and sisters, like I said, that this deen, which is Islam, and Quran has told us that this deen is supposed to be spread throughout the dunya and it's not supposed to be hidden. And Shiaism, what do we say? The Shia imams have said it's supposed to be hidden. This is a clear contradiction and shows that you cannot call Shiaism Islam. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.